this month's e-magazine, I've come to Peg 9 on Gold Lake here at Gold Valley, and it gives me the ideal opportunity to show you how I go about feeder fishing towards an island. It's come to that time of year where island pegs on all the commercial fisheries are really going to start producing big weights, and there's certain little tricks that I use to go about getting these big weights, and more importantly, not getting in a mess. And when I say a mess, I mean hooking the island, getting cut off, because as you know, a lot of these island pegs, especially when you're fishing to a point like we are here on Peg 9, the ground can be quite rough where it's eroded away and it's left those bare rocks and those sharp stones obviously visible. And if your line goes over them, there's only one thing going to happen. Even fishing really heavy 10-pound line, it's going to snap like that. Any little breakages like that and mishaps are obviously going to cost you valuable time and weight of fishing the net at the end of the day. And there are little tricks that I use as far as accuracy and where to actually fish. But like I say, we'll talk about that more in depth. The second method I'm going to cover is the edge. A little bit of a twist today. As you all know, I'm a great fan of fishing in the correct depth, trying to get close to the bank. It's gone down to 2 degrees last night and the fishing could be quite difficult today. And what I'm going to do is just edge away from the bank a little bit into that 2.5, 2.75 foot of water where I know late in the session I can definitely catch one or two fish, or have the chance of catching one or two fish. It really has reached that time of year. Although it is quite chilly today and the night's been quite cold, the fish are starting to move. And it's when you draw a peg like this, when you're fishing to an island, coupled with an edge peg, that you really do need to know a few of the little tricks of the trade to get the most from your peg, not getting a mess. I see people casting into the wrong place, casting not accurate enough, and like I say, they're not going to make the most of that peg. And when you do draw a peg, like Peg 9 at Gold Valley, you do need to take the opportunity and try to win the match. Today I'm going to be fishing with my favourite feeder at the moment, which is the Guru Hybrid feeder. It's quite a long chuck here on Peg 9. It's about 50-55 turns to where I'm going to fish. The 36 gram hybrid feeder gets there easily. 10 pound Dava ST mainline and the shocker. Again, nothing's changed there. I'm an advocate of gear that you trust, gear that never lets you down, stick to it. Even though we're casting a bit further today, but again, we're going to the casting in more detail. You might have heard me talk when I say where to fish when you're casting to an island. Obviously, if you've got an island in front of you and you're casting up to it, it's an idea to have a few casts before the match, get your clip right. That way you'll be starting the match fine. But today we're actually fishing on the point, which to me is even more of a challenge because the fish can go that way. When you've got an island in front of you, the fish can go left, right or towards you. When they can go that way, when you're fishing on a point of an island, it really is entering the lion's den. It really is to the point of the rod's going to go round and things, it's going to go off. They're going to try and get over the point of the island and snap you off. You know, the fish, I don't say that they're clever, but what they are, they're very streetwise. They know exactly where they are and what's going on in their lake. And given the chance, they will break you. And what I try to do on pegs like this, and it's something that one of the local anglers, Linus Neal, clued me up on quite a few years ago. And when I'd sat down and thought about his thinking, it became quite apparent to me that what he was saying made a lot of sense. And it also, since that day, has caught me a lot of fish when I've drawn pegs like this. And what I'm trying to do, when you've got the point of the island, you've obviously got the shallow point here going out from the island. And I try to fish on the lip that's my side. This way I can get a jump on the fish when the rod goes round. They're not already on top of the bar and going over it. They're still this side of it. And it may not be the best place to hook a lot of fish, but what it does enable me to do is the fish that are hooked get put in the net. Maybe if I fished on top of the bar, I'd hook 20 fish, but I'd probably only get 10 in because they've only got to move 2 meters and they're over the back. With the stretch in the line at this distance and the bend in the rod, that's easily done. But what you'll see today, hopefully, if I hook a few, I'm dropping it just short. I've cast to the point and I've come back about 3 turns where I think it's about 3.5 foot deep. And I can just nudge the feeder and the feeder almost rolls down. And this is what I'm looking for, to fish on that slope onto the point of the island. That way when the fish takes the bait and I pick the rod up and pull, I've already got the jump on them. They're not going over the back of the bar, and that's how you get cut off. And that is one of the tips that a lot of anglers do keep to themselves and a lot of anglers don't actually know about. It's little things like this when you're fishing pegs like this that can make the difference between winning and losing. The bait that I've bought for today's session on the hybrid feeder, again, it's going to be the micro pellets. I've also mixed up some old ghost krill. This is, as we've talked in the past, is a little bit of an impact. If it's not going to plan, then I'm going to change to a 50-50 ground bait and micro mix. The micros have been soaked. Again, you can see that they go into a ball nice and easily, and they're going to be moulded onto the hybrid feeder. As far as the edge is concerned, maybe a little bit of ground bait, but because it's gone cold, and I've been fishing here at Gold Valley quite a lot recently, definitely micros and corn. For some reason, the carp seem to want to come in over this. And the last match I fished here at Gold, I primed that edge peg up, fed it, as we've spoke about before, made the fish confident. And I only went down there with about 6 or 7 minutes to go. I missed two bites, and then the next bite resulted in a 16 pounder. And I ended up winning the match quite easily. I didn't need the fish that day, but the amount of times that I've caught one or two fish late down the edge after priming it up all day, and those fish have made the difference, is unbelievable. One or two big fish, you could catch two fish for 30 or 40 pound here at Gold Valley, not just here, but on a lot of commercials. As far as the feed is concerned, obviously there's a multitude of hook baits that you could use. At Gold Valley at the moment, the wafters are definitely the number one bait. The fish seem to recognise them and they seem to pick them up quite willingly. There's two different shapes, the round and the slightly pellet shaped one, and that's one that I'll be using today. Like I say, I have been trialling a range of old ghost products, but again, that's something that I've used through the winter in slightly different colours, white and yellow. But here at Gold Valley at the moment, the orange wafters are definitely the number one hook bait. Cast into an island. Don't be afraid before the match to have quite a few practice casts, especially if you're faced with an island in front of you and you need to drop it nice and accurately in amongst, right against the bank. One or two little tips that I do use. Again, I've got a marker pen for the line. This to me is vitally important. Why? When I've cast out and I've decided where I'm going to fish and I've clipped up, you can still get a fish go to the right or to the left and take you to your line clip. I'm going to unclip it. When I've actually unclipped because the fish is running, if I don't mark the line, then I've got a problem. I need to cast out and try by sight or memory to relocate the area that I've been fishing. All I'm going to do, first of all, when I decide where I'm going to fish, is just mark the line with the little wax crayon. It leaves a nice yellow mark on the line. If I have to unclip and let the fish go, then obviously I'm going to be able to relocate the distance that I'm fishing very, very easily. I've got a good rod set up today. It's the Arity 10-foot feeder. You can see that I've got the fluorocarbon shock leader again, which again, I think just catches me more fish. It's a confidence thing, but a lot of people now are using them. You can see the 36 gram Guru hybrid feeder. Black elastic again, just gives me that little bit of extra security. A nice 4-inch hook length with a nice bright bait. Again, I'm fishing very heavy. But what you're going to notice if we start hooking one or two fish, I'm going to get the bite and immediately I'm going to be pulling, getting them this side of that bar. You really have to show them who's boss. I am willing to unclip, but only if the fish goes slightly to the right or even to the left, then I will unclip. It really is a case of standoff. You're fishing for big fish in shallow water that, given the chance, will take you to the cleaners and snap your line. Even the 12 pound fluorocarbon, it won't stand a chance when the line's stretched and it goes over a sharp rock. So basically today is really talking about locating the correct area where to fish in your peg when you're faced with a point of an island. And there are a lot of these pegs on different commercials. I'm going to start the session now trying to cast nice and accurately to the desired area, which, as I've found, is just off the lip of the point of the island, and it really is a fantastic place to fish. You might hook more fishing in the real shallow water, but for me, I'd rather hook slightly less but get them all in. The edge line, I'm going to feed it from the word go today. We started quite late in the day today, hopefully because the edge line might just kick in later. But what I'm going to do, and you'll probably see this through the session, is I'll keep feeding it, and really treat it like a match, and towards the end of the match have a look, and if I can catch a few fish on the hybrid feeder cast to the island in the first 3 or 4 hours, and then top it up with some decent fish, even if it's only one or two down the edge late on. The timings have worked and I've got it right. But more importantly, I don't want to be frustrated afterwards having lost fish that, if it was a match, could well have won me it. Okay, just before I start on the hybrid feeder, I'm going to have a quick look at the pole rig. As you can see, it's that time of year again. I've stepped up to the power kits. I've got the purple hydro running through the puller kit. Very strong kit. Just a little footnote. You see what I've started to do now is mark the depths. So I've got half a foot, 1 foot, 1.5 feet, 2, 2.5 and 3, just with the white, with the red marks. And all this enables me to do is to fish very accurately in the depth of water I want to fish in. I know for a fact when I won the match the other day, you can see my mark there, 2.5 feet, slightly less. And that's the depth I'm going to look to fish in today. It's a very similar day, quite a brisk southwesterly wind, quite cold overnight, and I did hook one in that depth. So again, keeping notes like this will definitely stand you in good stead. As far as the rig's concerned, again, very heavy, very durable. I've got a size 14 gamma power carp hook, my number one hook for margin fishing. I've got a nice little bulk of number eights there. You can see with a few trimming styles. Again, just a bulk, 9 inches from the hook. And again, the old faithful, the KC Carper Rock. Again, I've caught so many fish on these. They're very user friendly, they're easy to shot, a nice thick tip that you can dot down. It's not going to fly under at the slightest of indications, and very, very strong. As you know, I really am a massive fan of strong tackle, reliable tackle, tackle that's not going to let me down. If I've fed an edge peg all day and I go in with 5 minutes to go, hook one and my float breaks, obviously that's made the whole day a little bit of a waste of time. So the last thing you want to do is be dropping in and having your gear let you down. If you're happy with tackle, be it reel line, shock leaders, rods, floats, hooks, stick with it, because there's a lot more important things like where to fish and how to feed. Once you're happy with your tackle and it's not going to let you down, stick to it and worry about the more important things. Just about to cast again, loading up the hybrid feeder with the micros. Again, I'm really taking my time. Even though the fish are starting to wake up a little bit, it's not going to be that good today. It's been very cold overnight, so I will be sitting and waiting for a little bit. So I want to make sure that the feeder's loaded right, so that when it lands, it gives me the best chance. Because we're casting quite a way today and there is quite a stiff wind, I actually stand up when I cast. This just gives me a little bit more momentum and just gives me that accuracy and distance when I'm casting towards the point of the island. Perfect. Because of the strong wind, I'm just holding the rod down. Because I'm fishing on that slope, if I create a big bow in the line, it's going to pull the feeder down. So I'm just making sure the line's all sunk before I put the rod down. Again, using the timer. Wind's really picking up strong now. Well, there we go. First fish. Third cast, I expected it to be hard today purely because of the temperature was down, but the tip hammered round, but because of where we're fishing in the peg, literally I picked the rod up, applied quite a bit of pressure, and the fish was back down this side of the island and in the deep water, and it's exactly what I wanted to achieve today. It really is the best place to fish these pegs. And I know that if you tackle these pegs like this, you hardly lose any fish. Yeah, you'll still get an odd hook pull, but as far as getting cut off having your whole rig destroyed and having to set up again or start again with another rod. It just doesn't happen if you target the right area of your swim. Now these fish are waking up. Although it's been cold last night and I don't expect to catch hundreds today, but now the fish are waking up on that bite, they can be quite savage. And if you're not careful and fishing the wrong part of your peg where these islands are, you can be snapped off in a matter of seconds. See, not the biggest one in the lake, but again, a nice fish to get us started, around about 5 or 6 pound, nicely in the corner. Absolutely perfect. 100% muscle, and given the chance, if you're fishing the wrong place in your peg, these ones are going to cut you off. It could be the beginning of the end. But targeting these fish at the right place of your peg, it can make your whole day a lot easier. What I'm going to do now, I've already fed the edge peg once. It's an ideal opportunity after every fish just to keep that bait going in. I'm a massive fan of feeding that edge line on a regular basis so that when I do go down there, they're going to be a lot more confident if there is some fish in the area. See, I lost the hook bait that time with the bait spike. So easy and quick to bait up, and that's what it's about. Like I say, today I don't expect it to be absolutely brilliant, but in the summer when they're really having it, you need not only reliable tackle but fast and efficient tackle. You can see how quickly there I put a bait on ready to cast out. Going to stand up, that wind's getting up a tiny bit. And that's nowhere near where I wanted it. You see there, I've cast out, that went absolutely perfect. One thing I will say, it's not easy to get it in the right place every time. And that was my second cast at trying to get it in the right place. See, a lot of people cast out, they don't get it in the right place and they're quite happy to leave it there. For me, it's a case of when it's going offline, of stopping the feeder and retrieving it and casting again, and if I have to, cast again to get it in the right place. Don't be afraid to stop the feeder and recast. Even the very top anglers, they don't get it in the right place every single time, especially when you're fishing at quite a distance like we are today. And what you do want to do is when you actually get it on line and in the right place, you're building up a little area. You don't want little spots of bait all over the place. You want to build up a little area. So like I say, one good tip, when you cast and it's going offline, you can see it, just stop it with your hand or your finger, let it fall into the lake and retrieve it, remould the feeder and back out until you do get it in the right place. Because the rewards of fishing accurately and taking your time, and also being confident when you're sitting here waiting for 5, 10, 15 minutes at a time for that bite, you want to be confident that it's in the right place in your mind. 9 times out of 10, if you are confident, you've got a much, much better chance of getting that pull. As you can see, just caught the first fish and I fed the margins again. A lot of people say to me, just tighten up a little bit, how often do you feed the margin lines? I look to feed them quite often, every half hour to 40 minutes as a rule. But again, with match fishing, keep your eyes open, keep your ears open, look at what people are catching. People are catching early in the edges, trying up the feed rate so that you can go down there earlier in the match. Likewise, if people have tried it and they're not catching, don't neglect it. Still feed it on a regular basis, every 40, 45 minutes. Knowing the fact that you're probably going to want to concentrate on one of your other methods. And like I did in the last match here, go down there with literally 6 or 7 minutes to go. go, there's another one. You can see immediately I'm having to really concentrate because I'm hardly getting any bites, but that one, it was round 3 to 4 foot before I could pick the rod up. But by adding a lot of pressure immediately, I've got it straight back this side of the bar. Can't cut me off. And it just goes to show that even these days when the fish are hard to come by, it's even more important. When you're getting one every chuck, yeah, you can lose an odd one and still do well. This is only our fourth or fifth bite, but we've got everyone in a peg that is notorious for people getting cut off, getting broke, having their tackle damaged. I do think if I fished another 3 metres further, right on top of that shallow bar, I'd definitely hook more. Would I land more? 100% not. Really is a thinking angler's tactic, this, that can really score and get the most out of a peg. So fit, which is again why if you fish in that real shallow water, they'll just take off and break you off above your feeder before you can even register sometimes. That's fantastic. One thing I have just changed, you can probably see it there. I was getting a few line bites and I've actually changed to a little yellow dumbbell. Again, it's been the number one bait through the winter. Although the orange wafters have been catching a few fish lately and through the winter, to be fair, I've definitely got more confidence in the yellow. And I just had a little spell where I had quite a few liners, no actual bites. I've changed to a yellow barrel bait, bottom bait, and immediately, after about 7 or 8 minutes of it being out there, I've caught a carp. So it just goes to show that ringing the changes can definitely get you an odd bite. And it'll be interesting to see if a lot more of those liners now turn into bites. I'm going to feed the margin peg again. Trying to keep the ducks and the geese and the swans and the coots and everything else away, but it's that time of year where they're all getting a bit frisky. And but it really is fantastic. I love going fishing a challenging peg, where in the last match one of my friends drew this and he actually hooked 15 carp and landed 7. He spent half the day tackling up. Perfect. You can see I'm just leaving the rod. It's something I don't normally do, but by leaving the rod low in the water, what I'm doing is I'm sinking that line immediately. Normally I like to cast, put the rod down and look for a bite, because some bites can come instantly. The reason I'm doing that today is because I don't want that bow of line pulling my feeder back down that shelf. It's only a little thing, but as we know nowadays, a lot of little things put together can give you a big advantage. Well, here we are, we've caught 5 fish and it has been quite difficult, but I did expect it to be because it was very cold last night, only 2 degrees. I've tried a little mix of ground bait. I've had a few liners on that, but I think they're from skimmers. There's quite a few skimmers out by that island because it's predominantly where a lot of the carp anglers put their bait. You notice I use the little bait boxes, they're much easier to handle. I've still got the micro mix there. I'm still feeding down the edge. Like I say, first cast on a yellow boilie, I actually caught a carp and I thought that might have been the answer. But since then I've not had many liners or indications, and I think it's probably just a little bit too shallow with the dip in temperature. But the main thing is we've hooked 5 and we've landed 5 from what is predominantly a very snaggy and difficult peg to fish. So on that front, I'm more than happy, because I know if it was a match, I'm not walking away thinking I've lost some fish that could well have cost me. I've hooked 5, landed 5. And that's really the object of the exercise today. Like I say, I'm still feeding down the edge. I've not seen any signs or anything, but probably a little bit like the feeder line close to the island. It's probably just that little bit cool, little bit cold overnight to really line them up. But again, I've set myself a challenge of hooking one down the edge. So hopefully towards the end of the session, I can get a bite down there and get that bonus fish that could make the difference if this were to be a match. As you've probably seen today, I've used the new Dawa Arity 10-foot feeder rod. It's a fantastic bit of kit. I really do like the professional rods, and they're probably the best feeder rods that Dawa have ever made, until they came out with the new Arity. It's slightly stiffer, enables me to cast slightly further. Not only is it the business, but it really does look the business as well, with the half Duplon handle, the small bit of cork. But it's that little bit more power in the cast and playing the fish that really does seal the deal for me. This is the number one tool in my bag at the moment for feeder fishing on commercials and obviously small natural waters. It's got a little bit more power than the professional. The professionals have definitely still got their place in my armoury. Smaller carp and also bream. Fantastic all-round rod. They really have come out with a special little tool here in the Arity feeder rods. As you all know, I'm a big fan of free running feeders. I have used the Guru X-Safe with the black elastic and the white elastic quite intensively through the winter for a lot of skimmer fishing and a little bit of F1 fishing. And I really have fallen in love with them, and I hardly lose any fish. So as you've seen today, I've actually used one for my carp fishing. It's just something that I've grown in confidence. As you know, in these e-magazines, I'm always changing things and just altering things and trying different things. And I like to tell you exactly why and when I've actually changed to something different. There's a lot less hook pulls. The bites are slightly different. They're not quite as savage, which again, when you're fishing against islands where the fish are going to go over the back, then obviously is all a plus. All in all, the free running ones still have their place in my armoury where the X-Safe isn't allowed. But 99.9% of commercials now do allow the X-Safe. And for me, the elasticated X-Safe is definitely the one to be using at the moment. There we go, we caught five or six on the feeder, and the session is getting on. We're getting towards, if this was a match, the last hour. And I just keep peering round. I saw a little tiny tail pattern, dropped it in and caught a roach. I knew that wasn't what was making the tail pattern. Dropped it in again on double corn, been there a matter of seconds, flew under, and we've got one about 8 or 9 pound. So again, it's just another little thing. Keep your eyes and your ears open to what other anglers are doing, but also keep a little eye on that edge peg, because the slightest giveaway can result in you going down there and catching a decent fish. But here at Gold Valley, they're all decent fish down the edge, as they are with a lot of commercials. But you can imagine if this was the last gas of the match, you know, not only have we had a good start on that feeder by not losing any fish, okay, we've not bagged up, but we've not lost any. And you can see there the size of these fish that we're catching down the edge. All of a sudden, a real good finish is on the cards. Here we are, we've got another one on down the edge, and you might not believe it, but it's actually sleet, which goes to show how cold it is. Unbelievable. Nearly May, we're sitting here absolutely freezing cold, and there's a sleet shower. But this is the third one we've hooked down the edge. It just goes to show that if the water temperature's high enough, then you'll still hook some in that shallow water. Fish can make a difference. When you see the size of that one, you know exactly what I mean. We spent quite a long time on that method feeder, or hybrid feeder, only for five fish. But when you can draw conclusions after a session, to me you're going places. We've targeted a specific place on the feeder where I thought I wouldn't get broke, wouldn't get cut off. We've hooked five, landed five. And all day we've been priming up that edge line, and we've gone in three bites and caught three fish. And you see the size of that last one, a good 16, maybe even 17 pound. And it's fish like that that really make the difference. As you can see, we're still in the middle of a bit of a sleet shower, nearly May, can't believe it, but the fish are still responding. And it just goes to show that you have to read the conditions correctly. Last night was cold, yes, but it's been warm, the water's still warm, it's quite a brisk wind, but it's not that cold. I know we've got a little bit of sleet in the air and it was cold last night. Reading the conditions, we've caught some carp in shallow water and down the edge. And it's little things like this, if you can sharpen up, be match fit and read the conditions and read exactly what's happening, you're gonna go a long way. As you can see, before I was actually fishing down there, I was feeding 50-50 micros and corn. This just gives a bit of a bed of bait, and the micros will definitely hold a few fish in the area. Since I've been actually fishing now, I've been topping up with about 60 bits of corn and putting my float directly on top and waiting. I was still with a few micros, but not so many. Reason for this, just cuts out any foul hook fish, just introducing heavy particles like sweet corn. It's nailed to the bottom. You get any fish come in when you're actually feeding, you don't want too many micro pellets being wafted around by other feeding fish, as this can definitely result in foul hook fish. So it's a good tip, just to switch totally 100% or 95% to corn when you actually start fishing, because this will be nailed to the bottom. Like I said, I don't mind the micro pellets wafting around and being disturbed when I'm not fishing, because all that's going to hold fish in the area. But when I'm actually down there waiting and fishing, looking for that one or two bites late on in the match, then I just want corn in there so that when the fish come in, they're going to be concentrated in one little area. When I plumbed up, I basically set my float for 2.5 foot, because I know that's the depth at the moment here that is definitely producing a few fish. It's where I caught in the last match here that I won. And like I say, it's a depth that I've got a lot of confidence in. And as we've spoken in the past, that depth to me is the main thing when you're fishing in the edge. I keep a lot of notes and little marks on my poles as to what depth and where. Different venues, different depths. It really does alter. Also, when you're plumbing up, I do use the new Guru 30 gram flat plummet, which is absolutely perfect. Again, all this little myth about finding little flat shelves and this, that and the other, to me, it really is a bit of a rubbish. A lot of people say you need to find a little shelf, you need to find this. For me, it's about finding that depth, whether it's flat or whether it's on quite a steep shelf, I'm not too bothered. But what I do is use far bank markers, near bank markers. Today I'm using a little bit of grass. I'm fishing about 3 inches past that and about 3 inches out from it. That's where I plumbed up. So it's really a case of fishing accurate. Try not to look for these little shells and these little flat spots that everybody talks about. To me, edge fishing is about finding the correct depth, feeding it right, and more importantly than anything, feeding it very accurately and presenting your float accurately over the top. You'll probably see we've got a bit of a wind left to right. And what I'm actually doing to counteract that, I've got about 14 inches of line between the float and the tip. So when I actually feed, I've got 14 inches more of pole out. You can see I've shipped back and my hand's on where the five joints are six. So that not my pole tip is over the fed area, but the float. And again, this is very, very important. Your float needs to be 100% accurate, right smack bang, not only on top of where you've plumbed up, so you're the correct depth, but right smack bang on top of where you fed. And it just goes to show today, we've hooked four down the edge, we've landed four, we've not foul hooked any. And it really does go to show that accurate plumbing up, accurate feeding, all put together, results in one thing, and that's a lot more fish in the net. You get little quiet spells. Like I say, the first three that I hooked came in quite quick succession. Now it's gone a little bit quiet. I had a little indication a minute ago, but I think it was a liner. Seemed ever so slow. But it's a case of being patient. They're big fish in the edge. And if you're getting odd indications, be patient, feed, fish very accurately, and you'll see. But if you go a prolonged spell of time without any bites, it's worth feeding it heavy again, another pot full, and just leave it and go back onto the method or another method that you've been fishing through the day. But the good thing is, when you're fishing in this depth of water in the margins, is these big carp, they don't really come in undetected. You can always see when they're there. You're getting swirls, you're getting indications. So it's a case of they're not going to come in undetected. When you're fishing heavy elastic, especially in the margins, you do get an odd fish foul hooked, which can pull off. And the last thing you want if it's a match is to have your float destroyed or your rig destroyed. If you do lose one, you want to drop straight back in and be fishing again. You don't want to be wasting any time. So always play with the tip virtually in the water. Do lose one, I know that my rig is in one piece. I can drop straight back in and be fishing again. Feeding, plumbing up, smack bang in the top lip. There we are, we've reached the end of the session and it's turned out quite well. Been a lot of fish in the edge, constantly feeding it every 30-40 minutes after we caught one on the method. Also keeping an eye on my watch, not leaving it too long until I actually top it up. I want regular bait going in that edge so that the fish are there, they get settled and they get confident. Then I can go in late in the session like we have today and really put a decent weight together. I think it's been a brilliant exercise today. As you know, in my e-magazines, it's all about how to do it rather than filling the net full of fish, although we have actually filled the net quite full today. But like I say, the reason I wanted to sit here on peg 9 today and go through the actual tactics that I've been through today and where to actually fish in the peg is because I think it's vitally important. There's some big matches, not just here at Gold Valley, but on a lot of other commercials, Maver Matchlesses, Fisher Manias, big high profile matches where there's a lot of money to be won. And if you're lucky enough to draw a peg like peg 9 at Gold, you've got to make the most of it. And fishing in the right place is probably the most important decision you'll make when you draw a peg like this. Yes, if I'd have fished in the real shallow water, I probably would have hooked a few more, but 110% I wouldn't have landed them all. I'd have had to set up again because there's very sharp rocks that are going to cut through my main line, and all in all, it's going to be a bit of a disaster. So by fishing slightly shorter on that slope, just away from the real shallow bit, when you get that bite, you get the jump on the fish. Pull really hard, you're not going to get cut off. You get it away from that bar into the deep water, and basically, barring a little bit of unluckiness with the hook pulling at the net, that fish is yours. So like I say, today it's been about targeting a Pacific area on Pacific pegs. Probably a little bit specialised, but if you do get to draw a peg like this and you want to make the most of it, I'm sure it will stand you in good stead. Going back to the edge, like I said, I fed it quite regular, 50-50 micros and corn. When I went on it, I cut out a lot of the micros, probably 95% corn. 60-70 bits of corn, positioning the rig directly on top of where you fed and holding it dead still. Any slow movements, ignoring them, waiting for that float to whack under. I fished about an inch over depth, and like I say, we really have put some real decent fish in excess of 15 pounds in the net. And it just goes to show, if you get your timings right, the feeding right, and you understand exactly where to fish in these pegs, then, as I said earlier, you're going to become very, very hard to beat. Well, there we go. It's been a fantastic day. The sleet and snow's actually stopped now, and it is quite warm. I'm going to get the gear away. We've got a few too many fish to actually lift out, so I'll roll them to the top of the net and then we can see exactly what we've actually caught. Well, there we go. That's just a few of the ones we managed to catch. Fantastic size. Look at that big old common there. Massive fish. Had one real decent one on the feeder as well. You can see the sort of weights you can catch on these pegs. The size of the fish, especially the margin fish, is a real big mirror there. See that one there? Probably the biggest fish of the day, 16-17 pounds. Nice big ghosty, that one was on the feeder. Absolutely fantastic. Massive weight of fish on what was quite a cold day. But sticking to fishing in that little bit on that ledge, away from the danger, away from the snags, regular feeding in the edge in a depth that I know is producing fish, all put together with the accurate feeding, the accurate plumbing up, has resulted in a massive bag of fish on quite a cold, hard day.